All right, guys. Guys? Guys, pay attention. I'm gonna yell at you. Because I will. All right, everybody, we're going to... I'm trying to get us to the point where we can leave a little early today. So, I got one more idea to talk about, because then that'll cover this one side of this handout. I'll let you guys work on that, and then we'll see what time it is then and see how we feel. And you're all like, I feel like going home now. Well, you can. Do you guys remember that handout about flipping a coin that we looked at a while back?
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
Thank you. I don't think I have any with me, so I just want to remind you about it. Remember, right in the middle there was this histogram, and the tallest bar kind of makes sense that it was 7, because we were flipping it 14 times. That's the average then. I would expect 7 to happen most often. And remember what I said, does that look normal?
Yeah.
Totally. I love it. Because where's the mean? The mean is right here, right? So what if I had a situation where if N was 14 and P was 0.01? Stay with me now. What would the mean be now? What's the mean for this problem? What's the mean for NPQ problem? The mean is N times P.
One, two,
0.14. Come on, guys. This is kind of sad. The decimal thing is kind of getting less and less understood, being less taught. Decimals are easy, is that really? 0.14. So the tallest bar should be close to 0.14. What's this wall here? Why is there a wall there? There's actually another wall here, too. What's the least number of heads I can expect?
Zero.
And in this case, the most would be 14. Is that cool? Yeah. Now, I'm trying to make this quickly make sense. The reason that this one is normal is because the mean is in a place to give it room to go up and come back down. So this guy, if this was the situation, then the mean would be like right there, right on top of zero, really, right? And then it would go down. Is that normal?
No.
Shit, no. And if the P was too big or something, if the M wasn't big enough, it would actually run into the other side, and it wouldn't look normal again. It would be like this. So somehow it's got to be in the middle of the picture, so it has room to go up, room to come back down. Does that semi make sense? So what happens is we're about to create a confidence interval formula for percentages. But I want to be able to use the Z-score chart to look up how far to go out. Is everybody still with me? So before I can use the Z-score chart, I got to know that what I'm working with is
normal,
because I can't use the Z-score chart otherwise. That's the whole last problem on the test. It's got to be normal in order to use the Z-score chart, right? So does it kind of make sense then that this has to be big enough to pull it out from this wall? If it's too small, it slammed up against this wall. So here's the check. If I have an NPQ problem, if we have an NPQ problem, more technically a binomial distribution, but I just like to call them NPQ problems. Then to check if it's normal, these have to be true. NP must be, got it. Grade equal to 5, NQ must be grade equal to 5. This one pulls it away from that wall. If it's 5 or more, then it has room to go up and come down. NQ pulls it away from the other wall. It's the other side. So if I pull it from away from that wall and make sure it's away from that wall, then it's got room to grow and then to come back down. Now that is obviously nowhere near enough of an explanation about exactly why it's 5 and all that kind of business, right? But we didn't get in the whole thing behind 30 either, and you guys were cool with that. To be honest, this is a real intro course. We get really light into some things, and if you want to go further in stats, you can learn about the real story about why is it 30, why is it 5. But this is now, if I have an NPQ problem, I must check this if I want to use, for example, the Z-score chart, because it has to be normal. Yes, sorry.
Those are 5s, right?
Yes, those are 5s.
And that's standard just for checking to see if it's normal.
Exactly. So it's the analogous to checking to see if the sample size is at least 30. If I have a normal mu and standard deviation problem. If I have an NPQ problem and I want to use Z-scores for it, this has got to be true. That's what tells me it's normal enough. Right, let me let that sink in. Now, to be honest, right now I'm going from 8.1 to 8.3. And the reason I'm doing that is because 8.3 still uses the Z-score chart. 8.2 uses a completely different chart. And yes, I have them. And that just sounds, you guys are like, what the shit, another chart? That's the, you know, and then we'll have another chart after that. That's the right reaction. So let's, this is the idea behind how to check if I can use a Z-score chart. Now let's construct what the confidence interval formula is going to look like. So somebody help me out. I got the mean formula right here. I did. What's the standard deviation formula for an NPQ problem? That's crazy. So sort of the same way I did earlier, I'm going to start with this equation. So remember we started with this equation, we said we don't know this, and blah, 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 we filled it all in. Is that cool? You guys follow what's happening? Okay. So, one thing we need to know is this symbol actually means population percentage, just like mu means population mean. If I have a sample percentage, you're going to love this. It's called P hat. Right, so the hat you don't wear. The P hat. You don't want to wear that. No? Yeah. Something happened to him. I don't know. So this is called, this is the sample. Oh no. I see where you went with that. I don't know. I didn't see the video. You saw it. You
no,
know
I didn't
that?
Watch it. I just heard about it.
It's not out there, by the way.
It's funny that it's
awesome. We're not even sure if it exists. All right. If you have no idea what we're talking about, then I'm jealous. I've actually remained ignorant. It's bliss. So. Before we replace this with X bar, right? Right. Remember that? You put an X bar there because that's our best guess. But now, what the mean is NP, right? But I don't have that. So what I actually use here is NP hat. Does that make sense? If NP is mu, then NP hat must be related to X bar. Because it's a sample information, right?
So it's equivalent to the X with the little line over?
Beautiful. It's related to that. It's a sample information. I love it. Now let me put over here, what is it we're trying to capture here? We're trying to catch the real mean. So I'm saying the real mean is going to be somewhere in what we're doing. Now just go with me here. This is a little bit freaky, but all right. Because this guy, real quick, this guy captures the real mean, right? So that's that little line means mu is approximated by this interval. So here I'm going to approximate mu, NP, is going to be approximated by this interval I'm creating. Is that cool? This is necessary for me to be able to do this last step. Plus Z. Now, what's the standard deviation in this case going to be? N, P hat, Q hat. All right, let me let that sink in for a second. Because we ain't going to know P. We ain't going to know Q, so we got to use all the hatted ones, right? Don't worry, there's no, like, P shoe and P shirt.
Is it really called P hat? Why not, like, P carrots?
P who do what? P carrots? That would be horrible. It's not any worse than P hat, but this is officially known as a hat for situations. I know it's a carrot symbol, but just appreciate it as it's P hat.
Fat.
I was waiting for you to say that. I was like, come on, say it. You do it. All right, somebody with me so far a little bit. A little tiny bit. So what I really want, in this situation, this is all about finding percentages. I want to find just the percentage. I want to approximate where the real population percentage is. Like the percentage of people who will vote for whatever. I want the percentage. I don't want a mean, I want a percentage. So what am I going to do? I'm just going to divide by n. So now the percentage will be approximated by p hat plus or minus this. It's trying to be a Q there, by the way. Just to remind you guys, we are going through the difficult derivation of an equation. That's got to be difficult because that equation, I'm going to end up with a place where I just got to plug shit in and I get answers. So it's got to be all the work is in this. This is all the work. We end up with something, I just got to throw stuff into it and out comes an answer. Ooh, it's amazing. Somewhere there's got to be freaking work. So it started with the idea that we know is true. This is just the definition of z-score, really. This is true, period. Then we said, well, we don't know that. That's our best guess. We don't know that. That's our best guess. That's the formula for it, right? Just with hats on everybody. And then the last thing I did was, I don't want NP. I want just P. I want to catch the real percentage, not the real N times percentage. Now, there is one little piece to this that I want to use some math to clean up. That looks bad. That looks kind of stupid. Hopefully you guys realize I can't just cancel the n's, right? Why can't I cancel the n's? One of them's under a square root, so they're not really the same amount of n. This is a whole n. This is half an n. All right, now stay with me. Yes, sir.
What's that little squiggle between np?
Yeah, it's not, so I can't put an equal sign here. So the next best thing to use is that this means approximate. So this is like the actual population percentage is approximated by this interval. That's the way to read that in English.
Okay.
But it allowed me to do this step here.
Okay.
Divide everything by n, and then I can catch the percentage instead of the mean. I don't want the mean, I want the percentage. I want to know if from 20% to 30% of people like lima beans or whatever. I want to have that same thing, but just for percentages now. So I want to get the n the hell out of there. So the last little algebraic cleanup is, somebody tell me, why can't I divide these officially? Because they don't.
They're not the same power.
They're not the same power. I love it. They're not the same root. Right? So we're going to do it right here.
Can't you just put it underneath the radical?
Yes, but when you do that, n
square
is the square root of n square.
So.
Is that cool? You guys okay with that? Hopefully, because it's true.
Is that also underneath the z? The square root of n square?
Yes. What's happening? Z is right there.
Yes.
Which is a part of this whole term, yeah.
Okay, so it's also divided by.
So basically, z is in the numerator, is the question.
Right. Yeah, totally. Yes. Alright. So here's what this looks like now. It's going to be p hat, give or take, z. Let me write this again. Square root of n, p hat, q hat, over square root of n squared. Now they both have the same radical. I can reduce. How many n's cancel?
One.
How many is left? One down there. So now I get p hat plus or minus z. I'm going to make one big ass square root because everything's under a square root. All right, hopefully you semi-followed the end there. This just explains to you why algebra is a prereq. Yes? Some neat shit. So, we can do this a different way. Is that cool? They're both under square roots. Is that cool? Right? This and this are both under square roots. Right? The answer is just yes. That's all there's to it, right? They're both under square roots. Okay. I just needed you to say that. Sort of like the whole, you're in an exit seat, tell me you can handle it. So I'm going to make one big-ass square root, because then they're still all under a square root, right? That's a part of algebra, is you can split a big root across things so I can put them back together. And now it's just reduce the n's. So you end up here. That is the equation that goes along with... See, the one we got earlier was this. Right? So if I want to catch a mean, I can go up and down this much from it. If I want to catch the real percentage, I can go up and down this much from my best guess, right? So what's this? I'm sorry?
That's what you're working with binomials.
That's what I'm working with, percentages. So like a binomial, NPQ problem, exactly. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Are you cool with where to go? Here. Do you understand when I put that there? Oh, shit. Okay, well, that was... So that is the equation, but what does that equation do? It catches, or it's our best attempt to catch the real mean, right? So the real mean is approximated by this interval. Do I need it there? No. Here, I kind of needed it there to do this algebraic step with dividing by n. I needed two sides to be able to do that. So I need that there so I can say, well, NP is approximated by that weird shit, but I want to know what the percentage is approximated by. So do I need this here now? No. When I construct that interval, it's going to approximate where the real percentage is, right? That's the idea. I like it. It might be. All right. Sorry. Reference to a very old commercial. So let's do a concrete example. Now that you've suffered and at least looked in this direction as I derived the equation, which is always the worst, that's the hot dog making of math, right? But that's why I love statistics. I want you to tell me something. I want you to tell me something, so I'm going to make you tell me it. I just love that, right? You're all like, well, you got frustration to get out or something, Jeff, but hopefully you understand. Anyway, we'll see if you understand. Okay, so let's try a concrete example. Using that formula now. That's the formula we use. What tells me that it's okay? Well, let me give you an example. So we talked to 80 people and find 72 of them are concerned about the future. Eight of them are willfully, they live under rocks, basically.
Or they're rich.
So we talk to 80 people and find 72 of them are concerned about the future. Create the, think of it as a nice number, 90% confidence interval for the true percentage concerned about the future. So there is, for example, there is a percentage of you guys that are concerned about the future. So if I slowly started to take a sample, and I kept taking a percentage of how many so far are concerned about the future, it's going to get closer and closer to the real percentage, right? So what we're doing is, we've only taken a sample of 80 people. That's a decently good sized sample. So the results should be approximating the actual percentage of people that are concerned. Yes, ma'am? Create the 90% confidence interval for the true percentage that are concerned about the future. Yes, sir?
So in this case, P hat is 72?
No. P hat is a what type of thing? Physically, what is it? It's a percentage. Shit. Yeah. So it better be freaking less than one, grades, all that kind of stuff, right? So please tell me, you guys can see the percentage here?
70.
How many out of how many? 72 out of 80. In fact, I would say that 72 is the number of successes. 72 is the X. And 80 is the N. So the formula for this, really, if you want a formula, is X over N. But please, dear God, if the problem says we look at 714 dogs, we find that 102 of them are undernourished. 102 out of 700, whatever I said, that's the percentage. I mean, you just kind of know how to create a percentage. That's something else that people don't know as well nowadays, because I don't know what the hell they're teaching in high school anymore, or below that. So what is 72 divided by 80?
0.9.
Yeah, 0.9. I like that. This is a semi-bad pick of numbers for me, but you're always going to round the percentage to three places if necessary, right? I mean, 0.9 is freaking 0.9. Yes, ma'am.
Explain the hat symbol.
The hat, all it means is that this percentage came from a sample. So P hat is like X bar in that respect. These both came from a sample. P is like mu because they both represent a population. So these are examples of parameters, and these are examples of statistics. I like it. Describe a sample, describe a population. Kick ass. So all the P's we looked at before now have been assumed to be population P's, right? That's why we haven't had any P's wearing hats yet. So what's Q hat gotta be?
One.
Yeah, I don't care what clothing it's wearing, P and Q have to make one. They're wearing hats, that's good for them.
Shoes,
socks, whatever, yeah. Beautiful. Like I just said, so if it's P sock is 0.2, what's Q sock? 0.8.
That's
right. Exactly. That'll need to. Exactly. So this, I don't know if anybody was like, he didn't give us enough information. This looks like very little information, right? We don't need a lot of. Once I calculate P, I know Q. N has got to be given to me. That's how I calculated P hat, right? There's P hat a couple times, so, you know. And then the only thing I need then is how confident do we want to be? Have I said that yet? So what's the z-score going to be? Look at the little baby chart that I told you about.
1.645.
1.645. Doesn't that sound familiar? Has that come up before?
Yeah.
And that's what the little asterisk, dude, and that's why they did it, is because it happens a lot. So z is 1.645. So now the formula. Do we have everything we need for the formula?
Sorry, so you said baby chart?
Yes, I don't know if you were here earlier. On the bottom, is somebody helping them out? Yes, okay. Or you do it the old-fashioned way, right? 90% inside, so there's 10%, so there's... So look up 0.05, you'll eventually get 1.645. The old-fashioned way always works. The little baby chart, there's three numbers that it's good for. So what do I put into the formula now? What goes here?
0.9.
Give or take? 1.645. What is this acting like now, then? What place is it in? What's it acting like? Compare it to x bar plus or minus z sigma over square root of n. Oh. It's acting like a standard deviation. That's going to come up again later where we use it as a standard deviation because that's what it freaking is. Is that important right this minute? No, but I do like to get you ready for stuff coming later. Square root, this is where people really mess up putting it in the calculator. Got to be careful. Square root of, what was it? 0.9 times... 0.1 divided by 80. Oh, that's another place people mess up. Put the right number in there. It's always going to be the bigger one.
Couldn't you always just put in 1 at the top because it was always going to add to 1?
I'm not adding them though, am I?
Multiplying
them, yeah. So this is really related to square root of NPQ, which is the standard deviation of binomial stuff. But this has been adjusted because it's a sample. That's another way to look at it. What did we do? This sigma, we divided by the square root of n. So aren't I doing something very similar here? not exactly the real story, but that kind of makes it be more analogous. So what do you think I'm going to calculate first, of course? The error, just like we did before, right? What time is it? What year is it? To do what, sorry? Point 0.9. Well, because you got to do plus and minus. So there's two different things. Sure, you can do that. Nothing wrong with that. It's just a really good idea to know what the error is. Because sometimes they'll actually ask for the error specifically. Yeah. So what are you going to hear? 0.9 plus or minus?
055,
sure. Yeah. So, you know, these are pretty much, you're always going to take them out three places because you're going to take these out three places. Does that make sense? Because when I make it a percentage, I want to have at least one decimal place at the end of my percentage. Now, real quick, do you see how this is the plus or minus 5.5% that you would see at the bottom of the screen? Why is it so big? Why is that bigger than the 4 or 3 that I normally see? Because their sample was relatively small. Like Gallup or Rasmussen or Real Clear Positive. Well, they just do all the freaking. You guys know any of those words I just said?
Yeah.
Yeah. They always use about in the range of 1,000 to 2,000 sample size. And that's why their error comes out to be 3 or 4%. We only used an 80 sample size, so our error came out to be 5.5%, relatively big. And now you just got to add it to 0.9, subtract it from 0.9, so I get from 0.845 up to 0.955, right? And then, it shouldn't be a surprise, you write your conclusion. Somebody with what just happened up there? Calculate the error, so then you can get your lower and your upper. Now try to write the conclusion. Definitely not, because you're doing 0.9 minus this.
Okay.
Now, I'm not saying it can never be negative, because that would be what we call consistent with zero, because it would include the chance that it was actually zero. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So it's not that it can never be negative, but here it's bigger minus smaller, so it's negative.
So we're supposed to say the true percent.
Beautiful. Exactly. We're not doing means on this problem. We're doing percentages. So we are blah blah confident that the true, that this interval catches the true percentage. Yeah.
Is there a percent?
But you say true percentage. Yeah. When I say true percentage, I mean population percentage. Is that cool? I gotta be careful because.
Did you say true percentage?
P. Yeah. Without the hat, because what's the hat mean? It's just the sample percentage. Yeah.
We have to write that out.
So here's what it looks like. Here's what the what happened? Be quiet. I gotta make sure who says my smart ass won't be too worried. So we are 90% confident that Jeff can't even read his own writing. No, that the interval. I put it into human terms. 84.5%. So percentage is sort of like your units here. 84.5% to
95.5%.
95.5% contains the true percentage
of people that are concerned about the future.
Of people concerned about the future.
Can we
right.
Put dot, dot, dot?
No, you can't. Only I can. About the future, I just wrote it really small. Yeah.
So this is how they calculate, like, during the election, how is 48% plus or minus 4 or 5?
Yeah, and to be completely honest, there are little adjustments to this based on weighting things to correct for possible biases and so on. So if you look at the Gallup, for example, they do talk a little bit about the weighted values and whatever. But this is fundamentally, this is exactly what they're doing. They just multiply it by a number just to correct for something or other. But it basically is this. Right? I'm trying to be honest at the same time saying, yeah, it's that. All right, cool. So, finally going to shut up for a little while. I want you guys to work on the side that says section 8183. The other one talks about T-scores, and you're like, what's that? So don't do that side.
Oh, yeah. It's about how well you like your team. Like girl, great team.
That was fun.